Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present Parchment and Old Lace by Laura Childs with Terrie Farley Moran. Narrated by Danielle Ferland. Chapter 1. Commander's Palace wasn't just the most storied restaurant in New Orleans. For Carmela Bertrand, it was pure magic. Carmela knew this for a fact, because she was sitting in their garden room at this very minute. And not only was she nibbling soft-shell crab and sipping an awesome Montrachet, but she was staring into the inquisitive blue eyes of her fellow du jour, Detective Edgar Babcock. Maybe it was the wine, no doubt crafted by Wily Bacchus himself, that had cast such a luscious spell. Or maybe it was the soft, warm light from the gilded candelabras, the old-world charm and formality of the place, or that crazy second course of oysters baked in absinthe and buttered crumbs. Whatever the reason, Carmela was definitely feeling it. Luxuriance, exhilaration, and romance. Sweet, bubbly romance. "This is so lovely," Carmela said, trying to pitch her voice an octave lower so it was sexy and seductive. Kind of like Kathleen Turner in Body Heat. Or maybe Lauren Bacall in one of those old black and white movies from the 40s. "You're lovely," Babcock replied. And Carmela really was. Her blue-gray eyes, fine features, and tawny-colored hair, this week's color anyway, gave her an air of exuberance and creative curiosity. She was toned and fairly athletic from lots of dog walking with Boo and Poobah, but still enjoyed a few sweet curves. And yes, she could be stubborn, but was generally quick to administer a hug or kind word. Carmela took another sip of wine. "I have to say, this dinner has been pure perfection. If every restaurant reviewer in the universe hadn't already bequeathed 4 stars to this place, I would have sprinkled them on myself." Babcock smiled and reached across the table to gently take her hand. "Why are you talking that way?" he asked. Carmela's eyes went slightly round. "What way?" "Like you've got the beginnings of a head cold. Or doing an imitation of a character from The Simpsons." "Oh. Then, I didn't mean to." "You've just fallen completely under my spell, is that it?"
"Well, yeah," said Carmela, reverting to Valley Girl speak. Now she wasn't sure if he was flirting with her or putting her on.
Babcock gave a low chuckle. "You're such a little cutie, you know that? One of these days, we're seriously going to have to—" "Carmela!" A loud, impassioned shriek suddenly split the air. Startled, Carmela and Babcock both whipped their heads sideways, only to find an exuberant-looking blonde woman grinning at them, all teeth and gums and big southern hair.
Hi, Carmela said as she scrambled to dredge her memory, to put a name to this face. "Isabelle?"
She said it tentatively, because she really wasn't sure that was the name of this young woman who just hit an ear-splitting high C as she stormed their table like a pirate commandeering one of the king's galleons. Isabelle's smile got even wider and brighter, and she said,
"You remembered."
"How could I forget?" Carmela said, when she really had forgotten. Well, almost.
"Has Ellie been keeping you in the loop about all my big wedding plans?" Isabelle asked.
Ellie was Eldora Black, Isabelle's sister and the tarot card reader who worked at Juju Voodoo, the little shop across the courtyard from Carmela's French Quarter apartment. The Voodoo Shop, a kind of funky, fun tourist trap, was owned by Carmela's very best friend, Ava Griou. "Ellie has shared a few things with me," Carmela said, lying as gracefully as she could. She glanced over at Babcock.
"With us."
Now she gave Babcock an encouraging nod.
"You remember Isabelle, don't you? She's one of the assistant district attorneys."
"We've met," Babcock said politely.
"Just 2 more weeks," Isabelle said.
She held up 2 fingers and then fluttered her hand nervously as her engagement ring caught the light and glittered like a disco ball.
"That's some gorgeous ring," Carmela said.
Now Isabelle preened a bit.
"Isn't it? 3 carats, a VS2.
"Sweet," Babcock said, gamely trying to interject himself into a conversation that had suddenly turned girly. Flustered by the attention, Isabelle took a step back from their table.
"I hope you two are still planning to attend my wedding." Absolutely, Carmela said. She had an awful feeling that she hadn't actually mailed back her RSVP. She'd been busy and scattered lately. What with teaching a series of card-making classes at her scrapbook shop, Memory Mine. Oh well. Maybe she could short-circuit things and give her reply to Ellie. Yeah, that ought to work just fine. Isabelle glanced across the room where two of her friends waved at her. One tall and blonde, the other short and dark-haired. Well, I'm afraid I have to hustle off. I've been tasting cakes with Naomi and Cynthia and a few other folks from the wedding party. She rolled her eyes. And now I have 1,000 other things to nail down. I'll bet you do, Carmela said. She gave a little wave as Isabelle scampered away. Bye-bye. Good luck. Then, when Isabelle and her friends were out of both sight and earshot, she leaned across the table and said, Do you recall me inviting you to her wedding? Babcock shook his head. Nope. Do you want to go? Do you want to be my plus one? Another head shake. Nope. Come on, Carmela said. Don't be an old poop. Weddings are exciting, romantic events filled with dancing, champagne, good food, and excellent cake. Carmela was particularly fond of cake, though champagne wasn't too far down on her list either. I'm pretty sure I have to work, Babcock said. You don't even know when her wedding is, Carmela snorted. So how do you know if you'll be called upon to bust an international smuggling ring of ladies' designer flip-flops or chase down a homicidal maniac? But Babcock didn't answer. He was suddenly frowning at the check that had been surreptitiously deposited at their table, running quick computations in his head. He was good at dodging bullets, that's for sure, Carmela decided. Probably from all the practice he got as a police detective. She narrowed her eyes and studied him carefully. He was quite a catch, this guy. Tall, lanky, ginger-colored hair, nice high cheekbones. A man who walked into a room and immediately projected a certain weighty presence. Plus, he had a penchant for snazzy clothes. Really snazzy clothes. Like Ralph Lauren Black Label and Moncler. Tonight, he was wearing a Burberry Brit jacket that widened his shoulders and nipped his waist. Always a good thing. Babcock glanced up and gave her a warm smile. Ready to go? Carmela returned his smile. Her upper lip dipped in a soft Cupid's bow, a luscious rounded lip that most women would kill for, or pay good money for in a plastic surgeon's office. I could get used to this, you know, Carmela said. She meant the dinner, the togetherness, and then some. The and then some, meaning the two of them would eventually head back to her place for a nice Sunday night canoodle. So could I, Babcock said. He held out a hand and helped her up from the chair. Then he slid both arms around her, pulled her close, and gave her a quick kiss. Uh-oh, Carmela cautioned. PDA? Babcock arched back an inch. What's PDA? Some kind of women's political group? A new design project? She brushed her lips across his cheek, feeling his warmth and energy. You know, public display of affection. Oh, that. He chuckled and grabbed her hand. Come on. Outside the restaurant, the November evening had turned cool and breezy. Though it was full-on dark, the exterior of Commander's Palace twinkled with multiple strands of lights. Turrets, columns, gingerbread swirls, and balustrades were all shown off to full advantage, gilded and glittering like a Mardi Gras float. Turquoise and white awnings flip-flapped in the wind, while the restaurant's trademark neon sign hummed softly. The whole of the Garden District was spread out around them, stately and sublime, as if it were its own proud principality governed by some unseen archduke. Lush gardens and wrought iron fences surrounded block after block of palatial Greek Revival homes, with a few Queen Anne's and Victorians thrown in for good measure. And if you stroll down First Street, you might even encounter a fanciful Gothic home owned by a famous author of vampire books. Carmela and Babcock walked down Coliseum Street, heading for Babcock's blue BMW, which was parked at the end of the block. Across the scuffed blacktop, where dry leaves scritched and scratched, hurried along by little puffs of wind, stood the notorious Lafayette Cemetery. Dark and ominous looking, this was one of New Orleans' oldest and most infamous cities of the dead. Here, crumbling tombs, ancient crypts, and hulking mausoleums stood shoulder to somber shoulder. More than 7,000 residents interred in a one-block area, attracting and terrifying swarms of tourists as well as locals. A chill gust of wind suddenly blasted them, and Carmela turned her face into Babcock's shoulder. "I was thinking that we should," she began. An ungodly scream suddenly pierced what felt like a fragile night.
"Help!"
Carmela clutched Babcock's arm. "What was that?"
"No!"
Another agonizing scream rolled out, but was immediately cut off. Babcock swiveled his head like a periscope. "Cemetery," he said sharply. He took off running as if a starter's gun had sounded, leaving Carmela standing all by herself on the sidewalk, in the dark. She weighed her options for all of 1 second.
"Wait,"
she cried, and took off after him. But Babcock's longer legs had put him easily 20 strides ahead of her. And when he reached the cemetery's fence, he simply grabbed hold of the top tines, wedged a toe into a curlicue, and vaulted over it as slick as you please.
"Where are you?" "Oh, geez," Carmela cried.
She knew she couldn't climb over the foreboding-looking fence in her tight skirt, so she pounded down the block to the formal entrance at the corner, lost her balance and almost spun out, then ducked through the narrow entry.
"Babcock," she called out. "Where are you?"
She slid to a stop and listened intently. When she didn't hear anything, she called again.
"What's going on?"
Then,
"Are you okay?"
"Over here." Babcock's faint shout drifted toward her. Carmela glanced around, decided that his voice had to be coming from practically the epicenter of the cemetery, and then took off at a gallop. She dodged around a row of low, flat, humpy-looking tombs, then sped down a narrow gravel walkway between two mausoleums that were iced by a finger of moonlight. The night felt even darker, more dangerous in here. Fear trickled coldly down her spine, and the exertion of a full-out sprint made the blood pound in her ears. Still, she kept going, moving and darting ahead. What could have happened? Carmela wondered. Had someone been attacked? That had to be it. None of New Orleans' cemeteries were particularly safe after dark, and visitors were constantly being cautioned to avoid them. Had Babcock been able to foil this robbery attempt or attack, or whatever it had been? Had he given chase to the attacker? Carmela spun around a stone angel whose upturned face had eroded away over the years from the constant onslaught of heat, wind, humidity, and hurricanes. She dashed past a row of oven tombs, stumbling as her toe caught on the corner of a marble tablet that the earth had heaved up. Righting herself, she listened again but didn't hear anything, so she ran left in sort of a zigzag pattern, still trying to get a bead on where Babcock had called to her from. Gray clouds boiled up, and the sliver of moon, which had served as a small guiding beacon, slipped behind them. Now, Carmela was practically running blind, feeling her way along, touching and grasping cold stone. If only she could. She ran her fingers along the edge of a marble tomb, cool and smooth as picked bones. She glanced up, hoping that crescent of moon might put in an appearance again. But the night seemed to turn darker, holding a hint of ever more danger. Carmela scuffed along quietly. She figured she was fairly close to where Babcock might have called to her from. Now if only she could see. A sound, soft and muffled, as if someone might be hunching themselves back into the shadows and hiding from her, caused Carmela to stop dead in her tracks. On high alert, hair on the back of her neck prickling like crazy, she listened as though her life depended on it. And maybe it did. What was that? What did I hear? Flattening herself against the side of a large, hulking crypt, she tried to modulate her breathing as best she could, tried to make every sense keenly alert to what was going on around her. But after a few moments, she heard and felt nothing. Carmela slowly released a breath. She was spooked, yes, but she wasn't going to let her emotions run wild. She was going to keep bumbling along and find Babcock. After all, he was in here somewhere. Carmela moved ahead 2 steps, then 3. Her right shoulder still brushing against the side of the crypt, using it as a sort of touch point. She was about to cry out to Babcock again to try to get a fix on his position when she heard a strange, low creaking sound and caught a rush of something. The initial spark in Carmela's brain told her it was a shadow coming at her, a grid of light and dark projected by a far-off passing car. At the last moment, she realized it was a rusty iron gate. The heavy, flaking, wrought iron door of the crypt had been flung open on squeaking hinges and was creaking inexorably toward her. Shocked, totally unprepared, Carmela had barely 2 seconds to get a hand up in front of her face, a pro forma protest at best, before the gate struck hard against her, pinning her tightly against the crypt's outside wall. She let loose a startled yelp as her forehead went numb and bright stars danced and flashed before her eyes. She suddenly felt like a captured butterfly pinned inside a display case. Angry, stunned, and struggling to pull herself back to the here and now, she gripped the gate with her hands and managed to croak out, "Help!" Then she heard footsteps lightly running away from her as she was finally able to shove the heavy door or metal gate or whatever it was off her body.
"Stop!" she cried out.
Now, her fear had been replaced with fury. But whoever had smacked her with the gate was long gone. Carmela gently touched a hand to her nose, mindful of sudden tears that clouded her eyes. "Broken?" she prodded carefully. No, she didn't think so. Just sore. But whoever had tried to waylay her had been fairly successful. They'd stopped her cold. She figured she'd probably feel battered and bruised come tomorrow morning. Deciding the smartest thing, the safest thing to do right now was get herself out of the cemetery as fast as she could. Carmela scuttled left, found a sort of pathway, and hurried along it. She was angry and scared and hurt. If she could make it out to Babcock's car, she'd hopefully meet up with him there. Boy, did she have a story to tell. But as Carmela lurched along, her eyes scanning to either side of the path, she almost tripped again. She caught herself at the last moment, glanced forward, and let loose a startled cry. "What is that? What am I seeing now? Someone had flung a coat across a gravestone?" Carmela blinked and struggled to focus. Wait a minute. Maybe that wasn't a coat? Is that a person lying there? Oh, dear Lord. Carmela moved forward as if in a trance. She was suddenly hyper-aware of every crunch of gravel underfoot, every looming grave, every sigh and hiss of the wind. Who is it? Is it the person we heard screaming? Had to be, as if compelled to bear witness. Carmela drew closer and closer to the grave where someone, she was pretty sure it was a woman, was sprawled in a totally unnatural pose, as if they'd been hurled there by some uncaring, unfeeling giant. Carmela was 5 feet away when her brain blipped out a warning message. Be careful. Be careful. Babcock. Where was Babcock? Now she really had to find him. She opened her mouth to cry out, but no sound emerged. Because by this time, she was standing directly in front of the slumped body. Slumped dead body? Feeling not only shock, but paralyzing fear. Get a grip, she told herself. Try to breathe. Make a sound, any sound. Carmela gritted her teeth and tried to rally her courage. She wasn't sure if this woman was dead or very badly injured, but she knew she had to try and help this poor soul. Tentatively, Carmela reached out a hand, and just as the tips of her fingers were about to touch the woman, "Carmela!" came a harsh voice. "No!" Chapter 2. Carmela jumped back as if she'd been jabbed with a hot wire. Then footsteps sounded, and Edgar Babcock slalomed to a stop next to her. He grabbed her arm, jerking her backward. "No, Carmela, don't touch her. She's gone." Carmela staggered back against Babcock, turned, and bumped her forehead again. "Ouch!" Then she stared up at him with questioning eyes. What happened?
"She's been assaulted," Babcock responded. "Strangled." He was using his cool law enforcement tone of voice, the same calming tone he used when he was tasked with speaking to relatives of crime victims, when he had to show up on someone's doorstep and say, "I'm sorry, but there's been an accident."
"Strangled just like that?" Carmela said. She was a little incredulous. "You mean the woman is dead?"
"I got here just in time to find her like this and then see someone disappear into the graveyard," Babcock said. "I took off after him, but," he gave a kind of feral snarl, "I lost him."
"I saw him too," Carmela said. "Well, I sort of encountered him."
Babcock stared at her. "What are you talking about?"
"Somebody. Well, I guess it might have been the killer. Was hiding just inside one of those big crypts. Anyway, when I came along, he swung the door open and tried to nail me."
Babcock gripped both her shoulders. "Are you hurt?" She pointed to the bridge of her nose.
"Just kind of banged up."
"You shouldn't have followed me in here, Carmela. This could have been a bad scene."
Then, as she glanced at the body draped across the tombstone, he added,
"Worse than it already is."
Carmela made a slight move toward the body. "Do we know who—"
"Carmela, don't," Babcock said. Now his voice was uncharacteristically harsh.
"What?" Carmela asked. She studied Babcock's face, saw something lurking there, and said, "What aren't you telling me?"
"I've already called this in," Babcock said. "So the best thing we can do now is—"
"No," Carmela said. Then, "Something's really wrong, isn't it?"
When he didn't reply, Carmela edged closer to the body. She bent down and asked,
"Do we know her?"
Babcock pulled a hanky from his pocket, carefully draped it across the woman's hair so he wouldn't obliterate any evidence, and turned her head gently. As he moved the body, Carmela caught a glimpse of the woman's pale face.
"It's Isabelle," Carmela said in a hoarse voice. "Please, no. It can't be her."
But it was, and she knew it.
"What happened?"
Shock and anger bubbled up inside Carmela. "Look here," Babcock said. His index finger hovered close to the dead woman's face, then dipped down to indicate her neck. "She's been strangled."
"Dear Lord," Carmela gulped. "With what?"
She really didn't expect an answer, because she was leaning in close herself, eyes finally adjusting to the darkness as she gazed in horror at the body.
"You see?" Babcock said.
Now even he was slightly choked up. Carmela tried to look past the awful purple and black welts at the twisted piece of fabric that was buried deep in Isabelle's neck.
"It's a piece of lace," she said,
sounding almost incredulous.
"Isabelle's been strangled with a piece of lace."
5 minutes later, the cemetery was a hub of activity. Police cruisers rolled up, their blue and red pulsing lights cutting through the inky darkness and attracting a gaggle of onlookers. Uniformed officers streamed in, along with two EMTs who brought along a clattering metal gurney. Too late for that now, Carmela thought. Now they would need the crime scene techs with their myriad tests and equipment. Police radios burped as more officers arrived, along with Babcock's right-hand man, Detective Bobby Gallant. They talked in low, concerned voices, their shoulders hunched, their heavy cop shoes scuffing gravel. Nobody paid much attention to Carmela.
Carmela wandered away from the circle of law enforcement that clustered like blowflies around Isabelle's dead body and stared at a row of dark, curious faces that peered through the wrought iron fence.
The lights and hum of activity had attracted these onlookers, and she wondered if any one of them might have had a hand in poor Isabelle's murder. Was the killer standing over there right now, watching the drama unfold with dull, appraising eyes?
Carmela?
Babcock was waving at her. Stay close, he cautioned.
You think her killer's still out there? She asked.
Her eyes were once again drawn to the dark faces at the fence. We don't know, Babcock said. We've got officers searching the area right now, talking to people.
Okay, she said woodenly. She could hardly believe it. 30 minutes ago, Isabelle had been inside a cozy, warm restaurant with a group of friends. Now, she was lying dead atop a cold, impersonal tombstone. It simply didn't compute. None of this did. The crime scene team arrived, deposited a half dozen black leather cases on the ground, and set up 3 stanchions with super bright lights. They were here to process the body.
Careful now, Babcock warned as they pulled on latex gloves.
The techs nodded perfunctorily. They knew their jobs, and they were always careful. Carmela hunched closer to Babcock. Under the glaring bright lights, Isabelle's body looked pale and ethereal. Why is there a crust of blood on her mouth? She asked.
Probably bit her lip during the struggle.
Carmela frowned and looked around. The cemetery was dark, lonely, and foreboding. Why would Isabelle even come in here? She asked. I mean, she'd been tasting cake, for goodness sake, with a bunch of friends. Why would she bother coming in here at all? Do you think she was taking a shortcut or something to get to her car?
Maybe, Babcock said. Or it's possible she knew her attacker.
Carmela's head pivoted in Babcock's direction. What did you just say?
There's a chance that she knew him, Babcock repeated, that she was comfortable with her attacker, and never since she was in any sort of danger. It would certainly explain why she came strolling through here.
Carmela swallowed hard. She didn't respond, because she didn't know quite what to say. But maybe Isabelle knew him? That made the circumstances surrounding the woman's death even more frightening. A sudden scuffle nearby caused everyone who'd been hunkered around the body to immediately turn and stare.
Stop it! Let me go! Shouted a man.
He was angry and struggling like crazy as 2 uniformed officers half walked, half dragged him into the circle of light.
We found him lurking just outside the gate,
one of the officers said to Babcock.
I wasn't lurking, you idiot. I was getting into my car, the man cried.
He was tall, with an aquiline nose, Dudley Do-Right's square jaw, and a shock of blonde hair that swept across his forehead, preppy style. His face was practically beet red to match his crewneck sweater. The man glowered at Babcock.
Are you in charge here? He snapped.
Babcock stared at him.
Who are you? My name is Julian Drake, and I'm...
He broke off his words suddenly as he gazed past Babcock.
Dear Lord, what happened?
You don't know? Babcock asked.
No, I don't know, Drake snapped. What's going on? I need some answers right now.
Are you familiar with a Ms. Isabelle? Babcock turned toward Carmela. Black, Carmela said. Isabelle Black. Drake sagged visibly.
Something happened to Isabelle?
He sounded stunned. I guess he knows her, Carmela said. She was murdered here tonight, Babcock said. He was watching Drake intently.
Murdered? Here?
Drake said. He spoke the words as if they were completely foreign to him.
Seriously?
Babcock stepped aside.
See for yourself.
Oh, no. The 2 officers released him from their grip, and he lurched forward and caught another quick glimpse of the body. Then he moaned and staggered sideways toward a low stone tombstone. He plopped down hard on top of it and dropped his head into his hands.
This can't be happening, he rasped.
It's already happened, Babcock said. Drake slowly lowered his hands so just his eyes were visible.
She's really gone?
I'm afraid so, Babcock said.
Gracious.
Drake fumbled in the pocket of his khaki slacks, pulled out a white hanky and mopped his face. There was a loud honk, and then he peeked out again and asked,
What happened?
She was strangled, Carmela said. She was watching Drake carefully. He seemed like a man in shock. Then again, you never know,
You were well acquainted with the deceased? Babcock asked.
I am. I was supposed to be the best man at her wedding, Drake said.
So you were at the cake tasting tonight, Carmela said. Drake stared at her.
Yes, of course.
He paused.
Who are you?
His question was ignored. Did you see Miss Black leave Commander's Palace with anyone in particular? Babcock asked.
We all kind of straggled out, Drake said.
He licked his lips and nervously jiggled a leg.
Am I under arrest?
Babcock was noncommittal. We'd like you to come downtown with us and answer a few questions. Give us the names of everyone who attended your party tonight.
Sure, but I don't know how much help I can be, Drake said.
He wiped at his eyes and gave a loud snuffle.
You can try, Babcock said.
10 minutes later, it was all over. Drake was escorted to a patrol car, and the crime scene techs packed up their equipment. The two EMTs took great care as they loaded Isabelle's body onto a gurney. Now they were going to hump it back out through the graveyard, with everyone shuffling along in their wake. Carmela shivered. Isabelle was getting her procession after all. It just wasn't the grand wedding day procession that she'd probably dreamed about. Chapter 3. Gabby poured a steaming cup of chamomile tea into a shiny black mug and handed it to Carmela.
Here, Gabby said. Maybe this will help.
Carmela didn't think it would help, but she took it anyway. Standing in memory mine this early Monday morning, she felt discouraged and weary. Gabby, her trusted assistant, was being her sweetest self. But even that wasn't giving her much comfort. Really, nothing could wipe out the shock and pain of seeing Isabelle's body splayed out on that awful tombstone last night.
I can only imagine how terrible Ellie is feeling, Gabby said. For her own sister to be murdered.
She shook her head, almost choking on her words.
I'm sure she's numb with grief, Carmela said.
Then thought, no, Ellie was probably sick with grief.
She herself was the one who was still feeling numb.
And what about Ava? Gabby asked. How did she take it when you talked to her last night? Or did you talk to her?
Carmela nodded. Oh, yeah. I figured I pretty much had to. After Babcock dropped me back at my apartment, I ran across the courtyard to Ava's place. Kind of dropped the whole thing on her, like one great big nasty matzo ball.
And she was upset? Gabby asked.
Ava was stunned. She felt terrible about Isabelle and was worried sick for Ellie. I mean, Ava and Ellie are fairly close. Ellie's been working at Juju Voodoo as a tarot card reader and astrologer for well over a year now.
So you and Ava didn't go over to Ellie's house? Gabby asked.
We talked about going over there, but felt like we'd be horning in.
Anyway, Babcock and Bobby Gallant went there to make some sort of formal notification.
Which must have been an awful thing for them to do.
Yes, Carmela said. And then we figured that Ellie would want to commiserate with her family. Or with Isabelle's fiancé.
So sad, Gabby said. Especially since they were supposed to be married and what was it? A couple of weeks?
2 weeks, Carmela said. She took another sip of tea.
What a tragedy.
For some reason, the fact that she'd forgotten to RSVP to Isabelle's wedding made her feel all the more guilty and sad. Gabby was silent for a few moments and then said,
Do you think it's kind of creepy that we're scheduled to have a wedding workshop tomorrow afternoon? I mean, we're even going to be working with lace.
She gave a little shiver. It is a little weird, Carmela said, even though Isabelle wasn't registered. Their workshop was all about creating concept boards to help brides-to-be narrow down their choices on colors, theme, flowers, and decor. The thing is, Carmela continued, it would have been too late for Isabelle anyway. She considered her words and sighed deeply. I guess we were all a little too late for Isabelle,
Gabby reached across the front counter, where multiple packets of beads and brads were displayed on metal racks, and patted Carmela's hand.
You're always so strong, Carmela.
And you were very brave to go chasing into that cemetery after Babcock. I don't feel particularly brave, especially since I didn't do much of anything to help.
Not yet, anyway,
Gabby murmured quietly. Then she brightened.
Carmela, what if we unpacked all the new boxes of paper and rubber stamps this morning? That might help take your mind off things.
Carmela eyed Gabby. You think?
No. But why don't we give it a go anyway?
Gabby pushed a few strands of honeyed brown hair out of her eyes and set her full lips in a smile. She was a woman who was blessed with optimism, warmth, and compassion. With her cheerful nature, luminous complexion, and penchant for pencil skirts and cashmere sweaters, Gabby was everyone's favorite. And even though she was married to Stuart Mercer Morris, the somewhat stodgy owner of multiple New Orleans car dealerships, Gabby always managed to project abundant good humor. Carmela and Gabby set to work then, ripping open cardboard boxes, exclaiming over some of the brand new scrapbook paper, and then carefully placing the paper in their floor-to-ceiling wire bins. Look at this, Carmela said. She held up a sheet of pastel pink paper. Handmade silk paper. Can't you just envision this as the background for a wedding or anniversary-themed scrapbook page? Gabby handed her a floral design rubber stamp that she just pulled from one of the boxes.
And this is the perfect rubber stamp to enhance that theme.
Carmela was beginning to relax and ease into a slightly better frame of mind. Then again, working at Memory Mine always did make her feel happy and fulfilled. She'd opened the scrapbook shop several years ago in what she'd always figured was the quintessential French Quarter space. That is, a quaint shop with brick walls, sagging wooden floors, and a bow window in front with ample space to display finished scrapbook pages, memory boxes, handmade cards, and altered books. She'd added a counter, paper racks, and shelves to display albums, scissors, and rubber stamps. Two flat files housed their larger format specialty papers. The former antique dealer tenants, who'd fled the spot, had left behind an enormous table, so that was moved to the back of the shop and became their designated craft table. As luck would have it, there was even a cubbyhole space where Carmela could set up a small office. And business had been good. Carmela had sweated out her first year, of course, but she was a practical, focused businesswoman. She offered dozens of classes and demos, invited potential customers in for free make and takes, and promoted her shop like crazy. In the end, all her good efforts had paid off. Memory Mine was now the premier scrapbook shop in all of New Orleans. Really, in all of the surrounding parishes. At 10 a.m., the bell over the front door did its trademark da-ding, and Gabby chirped.
There you go. First customer of the day. That always brings good luck.
But when the door pushed open all the way and the customer stepped into their shop, they saw it wasn't a customer at all. It was Babcock. Oh, no, Carmela said, even though she was really thinking, now what?
Dear me,
Gabby said, looking slightly rattled. That's one heck of a welcome, Babcock said. He was dressed in khakis, a light blue poplin shirt, and a brown leather jacket. He looked like he was ready to hop into an Aston Martin and take a jaunt up to Baton Rouge for Creole food at Jubin's. But Carmela noted that his face looked tired and drawn, and she figured he'd probably endured a very long night with little to no sleep.
What's up? Carmela asked.
For some reason, this looked like it might be an official-type visit, not just a pop-in-and-say-hi visit. How are you fixed for coffee? Babcock asked.
I can whip up a pot of chicory in about 2 minutes, Gabby offered.
Do it, Babcock said. Then, while the coffee was perking and the two women were giving each other glances, wondering exactly why he was here, Babcock reached into his pocket and pulled out a stiff white envelope.
What have you got there? Carmela asked,
One side of her mouth twitched. I hope you're not serving an eviction notice. Carmela always enjoyed a little droll humor at the expense of her landlord, Boyd Bellamy, especially since he was a world-renowned curmudgeon. Without answering, Babcock gestured for the two women to follow him as he walked to the back of the shop and stopped at the large craft table. He upended his envelope, and a piece of fabric fluttered out.
Ribbon? Gabby asked.
Eyebrows raised. She was wondering just what was going on. But Carmela suddenly had a good idea of what Babcock had brought them.
Lace? She asked.
Please don't tell me it's from last night. She couldn't bring herself to say, last night's murder. Babcock nodded slowly. I'm afraid so. Gabby put a hand to her chest, as if to still a fluttering heart.
Whoa.
She seemed stunned.
You mean, this is a piece of the actual lace that strangled that poor woman?
A shred of it, anyway, Babcock said, as much as the crime scene text would allow me to spirit away from the lab. Gabby moved a step closer to the table and gazed at the snippet of lace as if it was a horrible, tainted thing, as if it had the power to curl up like a serpent and slither around her throat, slowly choking off her breathing. Why did you bring it in here? Carmela demanded. What do you want from us? I've got our forensic people checking into various types of lace, Babcock said. But I wanted to know if you two had ever seen anything like this before. I know customers are always coming in here with bits and scraps of paper and fabric.
There's no law against it, Gabby said.
I realize that, Babcock said, keeping an even tone. But what I really want to know is, have you ladies ever set eyes on this type of lace before? Carmela leaned forward and focused on the fragment of lace. She'd been too shocked last night to take a really good look at it. Now, she saw that the piece of lace was about an inch and a half wide and had a design, a raised floral pattern running down the center. And it was definitely antique-looking, in a color that could best be described as ivory. Maybe I have seen something like this, Carmela said. Although I can't remember exactly where. Gabby, what do you think? Gabby peered at the lace.
It's pretty, in a horrible kind of way. And it looks like it might be made of silk.
Maybe French silk, Carmela said. And I'm guessing it's fairly old, probably even antique.
Which would make it expensive, Gabby said.
Babcock stared at them. Really? You think this piece of lace is some sort of collectible?
It could be, Carmela said.
But Gabby was more definite with her answer.
Very much so, she said. If you're into antique fabrics and laces.
Do you know anyone who collects this type of thing? Babcock asked.
Not specifically, Carmela said. She thought for a minute. Why don't we go into my office? I'll pull up a couple of antique lace websites and we can take a look. See if there's anything similar.
Good, Babcock breathed. Now we're getting somewhere.
Gabby and Babcock hovered over Carmela while she sat at her computer, running her fingers across the keyboard. This site, she said, Lace and Grace. They always feature a lot of antique laces, shawls, table runners, and bridal veils.
I had no idea there was even a market for this old stuff, Babcock said. I mean, why?
Because it's lovely, Gabby said, coloring slightly. And because it's handmade, whereas everything today is cranked out by machine, usually in sweatshops in India or China.
Okay, Babcock said, as Carmela continued to click along.
Take a look at this, Carmela said as she scrolled down. Here's a piece of lace similar to the sample you brought in.
Gabby studied it too.
The floral pattern is similar, but not exact. See, she said to Babcock. Your lace doesn't have an intricate lattice border like this one does.
It's called a strangling vine pattern, Carmela said. Gabby's face blanched white.
Oh my.
Babcock tapped the screen as he read the caption below the photo. And they're asking $350 for that piece of lace? Expensive. For 1.5 yards of lace, dated to between 1800 and 1850, Carmela said. She scrolled down some more. Look at this antique lace shawl. The asking price here is $1,700. Amazing, Babcock said. Why so expensive?
Because it's old and rare, Carmela said. Most lace from that era, if it hasn't been properly stored and cared for, has long since disintegrated with age. Is lace really strong enough to strangle someone? Gabby asked. Especially if it's antique? Wouldn't the threads be awfully fragile?
I'm afraid that piece last night was strong enough, Babcock said. The lace is stretched and tattered now, but it obviously held up. Carmela swiveled around in her purple leather chair.
We know that Isabelle was at Commander's Palace last night for a cake tasting, right? Do we know how many people were there with her?
Babcock pursed his lips. 7 other people, 3 bridesmaids, the groom, and various assorted friends. Well, you met one of them last night. Julian Drake, the best man.
Is he off the hook? Carmela asked.
Babcock nodded. Probably, pending a few lab tests. We've got nothing solid to hold him on. Carmela wondered if Drake had been the dirtbag who'd swung the crypt gate at her and bonked her on the nose. Or was he the innocent he claimed to be?
And the groom was at the cake tasting too? Carmela asked.
Edward Baudette, Babcock said. Yes, he was there, but he apparently left early.
Really? Carmela said. That's interesting.
Maybe, Babcock said. Or maybe it doesn't mean spit. Anyway, we know there was a whole group there just to taste cake.
He shook his head dismissively.
Cake.
But wedding cake is important, put in Gabby. She was a huge champion of romance and marriage. And a cake today costs upward of $800 or $900. So you really need to know what you're getting, what you're paying for.
Wait a minute, Babcock said. He'd just been gobsmacked by her comment. That much money for cake? He seemed bewildered. Can't you just, I don't know, walk into a bakery and buy one?
Well, no, Carmela said. It doesn't quite work that way. In the distant future, she might have to educate her beloved on the finer points of planning a wedding. Now, she just tapped a finger against her keyboard to bring him back to the issue at hand. What I'd really like to know is, with that many people surrounding Isabelle, how did she get lured away from her group?
Maybe because she wasn't lured, Gabby said. Maybe she thought she was with a friend, someone she trusted.
She hesitated.
Only then her friend
murdered her, Babcock said. Carmela gazed pointedly at Babcock.
Last night, you kept referring to Isabelle's killer as a he. Are you positive about that?
I'm guessing that it was a male, Babcock said. Just because Isabelle was overcome through sheer brute strength.
Still, Carmela said,
it could have been a female, a strong female. Could have been, Babcock said. We're not ruling anything out.
Because a man using a piece of lace.
Carmela looked dubious.
It strikes me as being somewhat odd. I mean, wouldn't a man be more comfortable using a hunk of rope or a plastic cord?
You know, Gabby said, I don't think comfort was ever a consideration.
Chapter 4.
Just as Carmela was shuffling through a stack of French ephemera, the front door swung open and a frazzled-looking woman swooped in, propelling her young, tween-aged daughter ahead of her.
You don't want to do this now, the mom was saying to the reluctant-looking girl. But I guarantee you'll thank me when your photos are all organized and your scrapbook comes together.
The girl shrugged her shoulders so high that her bright pink cropped t-shirt rose to reveal a silver chain around her waist. Interlocking stars dangled from it, winking and twinkling in the light. Then she dropped her shoulders, and the chain slipped back down over her non-existent hips. Carmela was amused. Good girl, she thought. Just a chain, no pierced navel. She put on her helpful shopkeeper's face. May I help you, ladies?
I hope so, the woman said.
She flipped open her oversized canvas bag and pulled out a brown envelope stuffed with photos.
We took a family trip to Yellowstone National Park and the Grand Canyon this past summer, and I'd really like to turn our mishmash of photos into a well-organized scrapbook.
She smiled at her daughter.
We're hoping it can be a kind of family project.
That sounds like fun, Carmela said.
She led them to the table and back, the one they dubbed Craft Central, grabbing a few sheets of colorful paper along the way.
I've got some paper that's edged with trees and mountains. She smiled at the girl. And did you know that Paper Wizard even makes a National Parks collection? She set the pages down on the table.
Let me see those, said the girl.
She picked them up and studied them. Her eyebrows rose in twin arcs.
Not bad.
Then Gabby dashed back with a roll of ribbon that featured a repeating pattern of ducks swimming along, the mama in front, with five babies behind.
These are like the birds we saw, right?
The girl said to her mother.
Flying over the canyon?
Well, Mom said, I think the really big ones were turkey buzzards, but we did see ducks at the lake.
Cool, said the girl.
She was definitely warming up to the idea. The mother beamed at Carmela, then grabbed a basket, and the two of them began to shop. They gathered up sheets of paper, rubber stamps, ink pads, and finally, they selected a lovely album. Carmela rang up each item, packaged everything in a brown craft paper bag with raffia handles, and then stuck a colorful crack and peel sticker that said Memory Mine onto the side of the bag. The two shoppers had barely left when Gabby returned to the subject that was first and foremost in their minds, the death of Isabelle.
If I recall, Gabby said, Isabelle worked in the district attorney's office.
Carmela nodded vigorously.
Yes, she was one of their attorneys.
And I have a feeling I know where you're going with this.
Mm-hmm, Gabby said. Isabelle's murder could easily have been related to her job.
That's what I've been thinking, too.
Gabby continued. Isabelle probably helped put some pretty unsavory characters behind bars. Then they sat there stewing in their own juices, with nothing to do but plan for the day when they'd be released.
Except when they were busy pumping iron or surfing the net, Carmela said. Gabby grimaced.
Still, there have to be a few guys who plotted to exact their revenge, who wanted to get back at the folks who helped put them away.
I'm sure there are, Carmela said. And when the wrong one gets released.
Because of good behavior.
Something awful like this happens.
Exactly,
Gabby said. I'll have to ask Babcock if he thought that might have been a real threat. You know, something he should look into. Carmela shuddered as she recalled seeing Isabelle's body last night. She reached for her can of Diet Coke, took a sip, and said, We've got to change the subject, or we'll be bummed all day.
Maybe I should run out and get lunch, Gabby offered. That always cheers you up.
It does if we get po' boy sandwiches.
From Pirate's Alley Deli, Gabby grinned. What are you up for today?
My usual, the fried oysters. How about you?
I've had a hankering for a shredded beef po' boy ever since I woke up this morning. When Stuart came out of the bathroom and saw me grinning, I do believe he thought I was fantasizing about him.
But you didn't bother to set him straight?
And damage that fragile male ego? Of course not.
Gabby grabbed her purse and glanced at Carmela.
So, another Diet Coke?
What else? By the time Carmela had unpacked a box of washi paper, found a package of silver brad she'd been looking for, and answered a few phone calls, Gabby was back.
Here you go, she said, handing a white paper bag to Carmela.
There was a big grease spot blossoming on one side of the bag, a sure sign the oysters had been deep-fried to perfection and slathered with mayonnaise.
And I stopped by the Merci Beaucoup bakery for some of their pecan pie mini muffins.
But when Carmela sat down at her desk, ready to sink her teeth into the golden, crusty roll that was stuffed with all that rich oyster goodness, the phone suddenly shrilled.
What?
Oh no, geez. I hope it's for Gabby. Of course it wasn't. Not only that, it was her BFF Ava Grieux calling. And the poor dear was howling like a wounded banshee.
Carmela, you gotta come. I don't know what to do.
Ava, calm down. Carmela gazed longingly at her sandwich. Just slow down, try to enunciate, and tell me what's wrong.
Cher, Ava cried. I need you to come over to Juju Voodoo right away. I can't do a thing. I can't seem to help her.
Help who?
Ellie, Ava said. She's here, now.
What? Your Ellie, Isabelle's sister? She shouldn't be at work today.
Crying hysterically?
Oh, dear.
I didn't know who else to call. You're always so competent when it comes to this emotional stuff.
Carmela began wrapping up her po' boy. Okay, I'll be there in a jiffy. She took a quick hit of Diet Coke, hoping the caffeine would see her through. Carmela practically sprinted the few blocks through the French Quarter to Ava's shop, down Governor Nickel Street, over Royal Street, and hanging a right on Toulouse. The day was chilly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.